खड़े to everybody. So here we are presenting you about concepts and themes. Okay guys, so good morning everybody. I am Srinivas. I am an architect, and we are starting the presentation on themes and concepts. As you know, this is very important nowadays. We have a lot of inquiries about interior designing, and you can see that there's a lot of appreciation for decorating the indoors, and a lot of things have come up with a lot of technologies and new things coming up, and that too during my during the corona times, this COVID times, is becoming even more important for us to come up with new innovative ideas and bring solutions for many things. So interior designing, as we start, a lot of times it always happens that we have some kind of taste, and we go by what is naturally available for us, or we also trust our own instincts. For example, if you look at the colors, my favorite color is red. It may not be the same thing with anybody else. So what happens is, generally, if I go with my instinct, there's every possibility that I may actually, in all my projects, somewhere or the other, there's a trace of red color in some of the rooms or some of the walls, and that may actually mess up, because what we are looking for is something close to personalizing the spaces for individuals. And when personalization comes, it is talking about customization. Customization is asking for the color of the choice of the client, and then we work over that, around that. So what is all interior designing is all about? It's not about your personal talent or your instinct. It is not based on instinct at all. It is based on the skills that you have and the flair that you have towards designing something. So when it comes to designing, and we primarily look into few of the things, like a lot of people may ask, when I keep getting calls from the client. They keep asking me, what do you think is appropriate here? What do you think is appropriate here? See, the questions of what and how to do, and what to put where, these questions are not the primary questions. The questions are basically, the basic question is always that is the backdrop of designing is why. Why are we doing? So here, context is decisive in the sense like, why are we actually in the first place trying to use this color or trying to use this style or trying to abide by certain kind of, you know, formulas and technique to, you know, define a space is what is mostly the most important thing in you know, designing the spaces. And you know, there's a definition to be given. You know, there was one project where we saw a client brought everything from China, and we could see that every wall had a different concept. Somewhere the wardrobe was in walnut color, somewhere you know, the bed looked like a contemporary one, and the mirrors looked very fashionable, and then, you know, there was too much of over decoration in the lighting system. So they were not falling in place. Everything is like, you know, you like something, you have put accumulated everything, and then you have just put them there, and it doesn't match each other. There's nothing, there's sync with each other. There's nothing like it is pre-designed or pre-thought and put there. So this needs a technology, this needs a technique to be learned. And irrespective of anybody's talent or instinct, one can always learn this technique. And today, I'm going to demonstrate how we can actually compose themes and concepts. So here we go. We're going slide by slide, explaining you different things here. So it's what we are talking about is somebody's dream, which is actually, you know, to materialize that and to bring it into a reality, we're actually trying to design. And the designing happens by defining spaces. And all the materials, the latest technologies, the latest color combinations, and, you know, blending them also is one of the styles today. So if you look further to this, we should have some kind of background for this, because the history is the background for how the styles and concepts have evolved all throughout history. Like, there were many eras. Like, if you look at the early Greeks and Egyptians, and how they started with their furniture designing, and then slowly they evolved into different concepts, and that's how it went. And you can see there were many trendsetters, and trendsetters in the sense like, probably we didn't know most of their names. They were just designers, unknown designers, and working for some king or something, and kings used to patronage all the designs. But the designers always had something which they tried for the first time. They didn't have any, you know, Google or some kind of net or Pinterest where they can actually download pictures and do something. They were actually doing to the first time. And first time is what we always cherish as those monuments and those legendary things which we go, you know, whenever anybody makes a tour to West, they definitely go and see these places. They see these Greek monuments, they see these Roman elements, and all the Western designing that's been happening in different styles. They see these places and they feel, you know, mesmerized by those designs of that time. And how much, and that too in a time when we didn't have, you know, Edison, you know, he discovered light very late, but before that it was only candles and something else, and they had to work in the daylight. And in those days, when there was no artificial light, they could do such monuments, which probably, and the first time, and this is the first time, like if I refer to Taj Mahal, do you see any copy of Taj Mahal before? No. So this is how, if you look at the history, it's been there since Greeks, then they were Romans, and then we had the Christian era, and then after that they were, you know, Romanesque, and from there they had slowly the influences of Islamic architecture, and then came the Gothic, and then we had the great Renaissance, where we actually had a great work by Leonardo da Vinci and Michelangelo. These are the great architects who were actually known, and they were artists, they were architects, they were sculptors, they were most of the people, and then they were all-rounders who redefined the antique style and then gave birth to many things. And then we have the Baroque and Rococo, And then there was a sudden change in the material that we were using. The materials became like the glasses. Probably the size of glasses were about just about a table size, maybe 3x4. But when after the Industrial Revolution, we could actually have, you know, access to having huge sizes of glasses, and then we had wonderful you know, steel. We had stainless steel usage, and many things which probably couldn't be done. And then that simplified our ways of addressing designing itself, and the way people looked at ambience and the functionality totally changed. And that gave rise to, you know, Bauhaus style and many other things. And that's what we are going to look into, how the concepts got evolved. So basically, if we look into what is a concept and what is a theme, so I would like to give some examples here. Suppose you had Independence Day, and on Independence Day there were many children wearing different dresses, like somebody had. And if you look at the concept, the Nehru, the people dressed in Gandhiji attire, these are all the concepts. I'll tell you one more example. Suppose you have Indian Idol. When you go for Indian Idol, you'll see that there is like today's theme is declared by the, you know, the presenter there, saying that today it's going to be folk. Okay. If you look into this, when they say folk is the theme today, then immediately every presenter there, I mean every singer there, tries to select a song which is of their native land. For example, there is some Maharashtrian who selects a song from his local place, like a Maharashtrian folk song. And then suddenly there is somebody coming from Telangana folk song, there is somebody coming from Bengali folk song, somebody comes from Chhattisgarh local folk song. So what are all these things? These are all the concepts. The big theme being Indian Idol has declared folk songs, and then these are the concepts of different regions. And then you have styles also, like for example, if you come from Telugu area, so there may be some folk song from the Srikakulam and some folk song from the you know, Warangal district. So these are something like which are like subsets of the concepts, and which can be called as you know, styles. So if I go further, I'll if you look into the interiors part, you can see that if you define this way, like the basic antique and Roman, Egyptian, and you know, Islamic, and many other, like, you know, Indian, all those things can be the antique ones. The Chinese, okay, because Chinese they have original designs. They haven't copied any of the Western designs. Anything original and the first time has its name given. So if you look at this Renaissance also, you can see that Baroque and Rococo, and then Art Deco, Art Nouveau, and all these kind of concepts evolved during this era. And then you had the modern. In modern, you can see the industrial, the Scandinavian, and contemporary. Right now, we are whatever we are dealing with. Like, as you can see, it's getting more and more you know, digitalized nowadays. Like, you know, you can see more and more you know, automation happening, and automation getting incorporated into the contemporary style. So contemporary is to the time being. So as even after 20 years, that will be called as contemporary of that time. So it's like that. So if you this is what we can define in the interior spaces. And if I show you one by one, considering that how it's going to be like, if you look at the interiors of the Egyptian style, can you see that kind of work on the walls? This is something called as fresco. This is a kind of art which traditionally we've been doing, and this is probably 3000 years old from now, or more than that. And then this is still there. I mean, people go still see this. I mean, generally we do paintings on the wall and they do not have a life, but see the kind of work that they have done on these walls. And this is possible because they have actually done on the wet POP, and they have added a lot of dyes into it and a lot of colors into it, and then they have done these paintings on the wall, which is really fascinating. And they have done to the ceilings, they have done, you know, they haven't left any walls. Everything is totally done by painting. So this is a typical Egyptian style, and this can be incorporated in today's. Now see, if you understand this this work, whenever you come up with a restaurant designing where you have to do Egyptian style, then you pick up these elements, these characteristics, like fresco painting and, you know, mural work on this, and then you know, you'll see that most of the elements, like the eagle, you know, the wolf, the god of death in Egypt, all these things you'll be actually incorporating as you go through designing. And you can see here they have wonderful furniture, you know, folding tables and folding stools, you know, folding beds, even what we use in our, you know, villages. Most of them are actually being done by the Egyptians, and they were primarily concentrating more on the furniture part. And you know, the first time drawers were actually invented by the Egyptians. And imagine if you use drawers and all these you know, folding X tools and, you know, this kind of gilding work on the stools with, you know, the foots of the chairs as the claws of some lion or something like that, then these define the characteristics of the Egyptian nature. So this is what how we come up with the concept. So when we make up a concept, then we actually include all these elements, and we keep them in sync. We don't put any foreign element. We can't put something like Arabic, we can't put something like Indian in among these. So that's how we think about designing. And then if you look at the Greeks, the Parthenon is the most famous temple that you know, which they used to use as part of the mythology as well. And you can see that these borders do make a lot of difference in this. Like they have this pediment, they have this row of columns which are called as columnates, and then they have beautiful capitals here, and they have very nice frieze on which they work. And as you see in Roman, you can see Jesus Christ motifs and sculpture work in these pediments, and it's an excellent thing. Even now people go to Greece, and you know, they have actually trying to renovate this and get this complete, because they have lot of visitors to see the ancient Parthenon of the Greece. Okay, similarly, if you look at the advancement in the Roman, what did they do is, like, they upgraded from the Greeks, whatever inheritance they got, they upgraded it. They started using frescoes like the Egyptians. You can see here they are actually very very famous for 3D paintings. Then actually it looks like as if there is a continuity of the walls. Like you can see here, can you see this? Like this is just showing you how they used to do the 3D paintings to the walls, also known as fresco paintings, but 3D paintings. It would look real, as if there is something, there is a window, and there is, you know, there is a corridor continuing. That kind of feeling you get. And the semicircular arches are as a very important element from the Romans. And you have semicircular arch. Whenever you see a semicircular arch, you can actually say, yeah, this is a Roman style of designing. And then you can see the beams here, the cornices, the skirting, the chair rail designs here, as you can see, just about 3 feet height. So these are all the characteristics and elements of the Roman architecture. And then you can see, as we shift on in after the Byzantine Empire and all that, you see the Gothic, and you have a pointed arch here, which they have taken from the typical Islamic architecture, pointed arches, and then they have adopted in the European architecture, and they have given structural stability, and they could actually reach cute heights, and they could actually see, they could actually do, this is called as a rib and column kind of structure, where you have all these very beautifully done ceilings, and this could actually give more light coming inside. And this Gothic is typical of the Portuguese architecture, as you see in most of the churches in India and in Kerala, in, you know, Goa. This is a typical architecture of them. So when you go by designing about Gothic designs, then you think about these elements, the pointed arches, the beautiful backdrops of glass, stained glass work, as they say, which they used to use tinted glass. They are not painted, they are actually true glasses, the homogeneous glasses, where even still we get the Belgium glass from Belgium directly for the red color one. Red color is very widely used in interiors. And here you can see, this is the Falaknuma Palace, as you can see, and this is where the transformation is happening. We are redefining the old antique into a beautifully, you know, more ambient, more luxurious elements are being put here. This is in Falaknuma, and the whole style of this, you can see the semicircular arches, and you have imbibed elements like this, and you have fountains, you have sculpture work. Can you see those doors, those beautiful doors here? And these doors are something which have, you know, gilding work here, and they were very famous. Like when Renaissance was being done, there were beautiful doors to the churches and cathedrals which had this gilding work prima facie, and they were beautifully done. And can you see this? It's even more luxurious than any other place, and you can witness this in Falaknuma Palace, by the way. And you can see some more. This is a typical Renaissance work. And when anybody goes with this theme, this concept, you can actually think about a lot of huge paintings, the most costliest paintings, and a beautiful framing. And you know, the full wall is done up with paintings here, and beautifully framed paintings, even above the architrave. The architrave is the one which goes above the door, and you can see a very elaborated cornice here with gilding work. What is gilding work? Like this thin brass sheets which are got into certain shape. Earlier we used to do the same cornices, smaller in size probably, but in POP and gypsum. But we have got cornices and different beautiful elaborate designs in the corners and ceiling, you know, extending to ceiling in gold leaf work or gilding work. This is what is called as gilding work. I mean, earlier contrast to the earlier antique designs, these are quite sophisticated and more luxurious as they look like here. Okay, so I'll show you some more works. Can you see the ceilings here? These ceilings, you know, there was a ceiling in Saint Victoria Church where Mr. Michelangelo, the great architect and artist and a sculptor, has literally painted with his hand on the ceilings. He was an ambidextrous, and he was actually painting with both the hands. It's a very famous painting that he has done, and he's a great designer that way. And then you can see the sculpture work by Michelangelo is, you know, it's different. And they used to redefine the arches. Can you see here? These elements were never existing in Roman times, and the brackets would be inverted, and some of the capitals would have the heads of human beings instead of having, you know, those orders of the Greeks and Romans. Okay, so going further, you can see what next went next to the Renaissance, extended Renaissance, is the Baroque style, which is very bold and very overly decorative and very massive, in the sense like, you know, they would have something which would be in fact mostly disproportionate also to the human anthropology, in the sense like it would not suit their anthropometry, like whether are they able to seated, will they be able to access those heights. The cupboards used to be beyond 8 feet, 9 feet, just to match with the entrances. You know, can you see the kind of luxurious work here? You can see the curtains almost coming from the roof. This is the trend which was being set during the Baroque. And Baroque is something which we tell that defined as, you know, something like a masculine style, gender wise, I mean, just to tell you. And then they would have very luxurious work here. You know, everything is metal gilding work here. As you can see here, there's too much of metal gilding work here, and inlays, as you can see, and the consoles also, which used to be put to the wall towards the end of the corridor, or even the middle of the staircase or something like that, used to be very luxurious and very heavy. But on contrast to that, there was one more theme which would be called as feminine in nature, and that is called as rococo. And if you can see the rococo, you can actually see the delicacy in which the whole theme is being made. The concept here is it has to be very, very delicate. So you can see some pink colors here and some pastel shades on the walls, and the carvings are very minimal as compared to the Baroque. And you can see, can you see that golden gold leaf work here and there, and the kind of chandeliers which are very delicate. And you can see that the sofas are actually more comfortable in the sense like comfortable for the anthropometry, like one can easily seated. I mean, they don't have the chairs and tables which are much larger and you'll have to take a footrest to get onto them. That's not happening. So in you know, early Roman style, or you know, early English style, what they used to do is for the queen and the king also, for their elaborate gown to fit in onto the throne, they used to have the thrones designed in such a manner where they could actually display those gowns of the kings and the queens. So can you see, the even fashion designing has some correlation with the interior designing. Like the thrones used to be designed that way. And if you see, the next revolution was the Art Deco revolution, and this is towards the end of you know, the Renaissance, where they started doing vertical members. They had wallpapers which would go vertical, and the curtains would actually fall from the almost from the roof height, not from the door height. They wouldn't just cover the window, but they would just be a decorative element as such, completely, you know, dominating there in the space. And you can see different set of furniture here. Mostly Art Deco is something which is a signature kind of thing. Like if I show you next picture, you'll understand. So if you can see here, basically the horse head and the converging designs here are the signature for designs of Art Deco. This you will find even in the buildings exteriors also, like architecture part also. This is very, very, very famous during you know, 1800s and all that. And then some other revolutions also happened parallel to that, and these are Art Nouveau. As you can see, it's the most craziest design ever. Nobody till then ever imagined that without balusters and, you know, having a railing not straight but curved was not ever imagined. And this kind of designing were done during the Art Nouveau revolution. Probably it lasted for 30 or 40 years, but the basic idea is you can see craziest designs. And people, whenever they make designs today, they have most liking towards this, and they, as it is, copy also. I have seen some beautiful work even done on par with this even today. So you can see here some of the furnitures here. They're the most craziest stuff, breaking away from the conventional designs of the antique nature. So this is what defines Art Nouveau. And then you can see some more designs. So can you see here, they have wonderful sync here happening with the wallpaper, the kind of designing on the wall, and the flooring. It's continuing, that same elements are continuing on the flooring. And you can see the winding staircases and even the railing, all of these are in sync. So that's what used to be the designing in those days, like Art Nouveau. And you can see the kind of entrances, doors, which were never, you know, part of any of those Roman elements being repeated anywhere. This is real revolution. This is what, you know, first timers, these were the guys who were first timers and trying to do something new, and that's what we try to look at, like when we go to West. And then came the arts and crafts movement, and then you can see here there's a huge you know, cut off from the regular conventional Roman elements. You don't see any arches, you don't see most of the cornices here. It's simple paneling, full length paneling, and the furniture is very you know, bulky and straight. I'll show you one more picture. So can you see here, everything is cladded in wood. The beams define that, the columns, everything is wood. And even you can see the paneled walls here, the staircases also in wood. everything. And they also came up with beautiful furniture like this. This defines the, you know, what is the style that was there prevailing during the arts and crafts movement. And arts and crafts basically started with those, you know, sloped roofs, wooden roofs of the West. Okay, so if you see further, you can see the Industrial Revolution came in, and then there were a lot of themes are revolving around that, with exposed beams, you know, rustic look, and then you had ceilings exposed, and then you can see here the flooring is also something which was possibility of that time, I mean Industrial Revolution time. And you had this hanging lamps, or you can say pendants, which were filamented, basically, which was a typical mark of you know, just the beginning of the lighting solutions which we had in the world. Because till that time, you know, when did lighting come? You know, around 1780s, something like that, or 1800s. I'm not sure about the date, but it was during that time that we had electric bulb and all those things. And you can see that very much in the kind of concept that was made during that time. I'll show you some more pictures. You can see here the way it is done here. The rustic look of the bare walls, unplastered walls of brick, and you have pendants which were mostly used in factories for working, and then you have exposed pipelines. And even today, most of the restaurants, we use these themes, the industrial concepts. And you can see more of steel being used here, and glass. So this is a typical of industrial advancement. And you can see here, as we got into the modern, can see more use of glass, more use of the alternates of timber, like in the sense, like you can see a laminated or a veneer doors here, and you can see more of metal here. And I mean, you don't have timber as such used, and there are a lot of, there are no carvings here. Absolutely, there's more emphasis on the lighting, the kind of plain flooring, undecorated, no designs on the flooring. This is the modern era that we have got into after the Industrial Revolution, and we are going on from here. Like, as you can see in the contemporary style, there's so much of work that's happening here. The grill work, as you see, contrast to what used to be the decorative pattern, or you know, experiments in the brass and you know, metal. Here we are using more of MS, you know, powder coating, and you know, different other materials. And you can also see the lamps here, which are totally contrast to what's being used in the olden days. And this is what is contemporary style. I'll show you some more examples of the contemporary style. You can see here the wooden ceilings being very plain on the ceiling. I mean, wooden ceilings in the was not a trend earlier. It was there like rafters, but now we can see plain ceilings and having concealed lighting here. Instead of cornices, we are having plain corners, and you can see modern fittings here of lamps, and you know, different wallpaper shades and different painting schemes, and you know, monochromatic designs of, you know, furniture and all that. And now we are coming to Scandinavian. Scandinavian is that theme, or you can say as part of modern theme, but and concept of Scandinavian, which talks about using the four neutral colors. What are the four neutral colors? The white, black, brown, and you know, gray. So you can see here the maximum dominating color here is white here. And here and there, maybe the flooring, maybe just the wood that they are using is something brown. Most of it is in white. Most of the people have a fascination for this kind of thing, and it looks more spacious. I'll show you some more pictures on Scandinavian styles. So you can see here, they must have done some, there's a rustic, you know, teepoy, but you can see the rafters, the flooring, which is mostly rustic, and the rest of it all, including the fireplace, everything is white. And you can see here and there some color. So once in a while, they use one color here and there, probably an aquamarine or something like a red color here and there, or an orange, along with these four neutral colors. So that's a typical Scandinavian style, which is the in thing today. Even a lot of people appreciate this this concept and they go with this. And to show you further, we are going east to see how, you know, the originals been there in the east also since ages. They haven't taken anything from the west, and you can see most of the ceramic ware and you know, the arches differently done than the European style, and they had ceilings also different, and I can show you this with the typical designs by the Chinese, the folding stools, the folded elephant legs, you know, those kind of things, and round rafters. They didn't have any square rafters here. They had all round rafters being used. They have more of this jali work here, which is very famous by the Chinese. And if you go further, you can see it's a very simplified versions in the Japanese. Even the Japanese haven't taken anything from the Chinese also, though they were ruled by them once. Most of the design is very simple, close to the nature, having more and more organic architecture, like, you know, the plantation, the landscape is all indoors. And then you have very nice low seating here, and probably they did the dining also like that. If you can see the dining here, it's very, very, you know, as if with their folded legs. On the right side picture, you can see that they have a folded legs and directly on the floor with a small back. So, and they probably the dining table is only 1 feet away from the ground. And on the left side, you can see how simplified and minimalistic designs they had in the Japanese way is. So this is the typical characteristics. So if you are actually looking at Japanese way of designing, this is how simple you have to really make it. And then if you go towards India, if you come most of the, you know, this is in Bulwara and Bikaner, most of the palaces which were done with this intricate detailing. And the temples, the Jain temples had a typical architecture like this, and this would be something like, you know, the indoors and the outdoors are almost similar. Whatever they had as the characteristics or elements inside, they would have something similar to the outside also. So this is a typical thing of the Indian architecture, and I'll show you some more pictures. You can see here, this is one Haveli, and you can see the kind of dwarf columns and the multiple arches, you know, archways, and you can see very slender designs, and the kind of work that is being done on the work, like a Gujari work, it's been done on the walls with, you know, metal cladding, like, you know, aluminium foils or, you know, brass foils used to be. So you can say metal gilding work in a different style. So this is a typically Rajasthani art, which we always see that. But can you observe something? I mean, these kind of square elements, these were actually Persian. So the Rajasthani kings used to actually call the Persian architects and designers to, you know, define spaces and make marvelous things here. As we import some of the architects, these people do, and they have patronaged the Havelis. And the designing was done in a more of a Persian as well as, you know, mix with Indian culture. And you can see here, this is a typical Chettinad style of South India. And you can see those columns and different capitals here, and different base here, and the kind of flooring and the leveled flooring. And you can see checkered flooring here. It's a different design altogether, and the kind of the doors that were there had different empanelment here, nothing to do with any of those Western architecture. So you can see here, this is also we are talking about the Persian architecture here, which has some trace of even the English architecture here and there. You can see some Roman elements here, but basically Persian. And this is the Chaumala Palace, which is very common, commonly seen next to Chaminar. And you can see the huge jali work and the intricate details here, and you can see these brackets, which is a typical corner brackets, which are part of the Roman architecture. But you know, you can, they're so well blended here in this place. And this also, you can see the typical Persian architecture here with different ceramic colors and different ceilings here and dwarf walls. can see these typical elements of the Persian nature and this square archway. And we also know the Moroccan architecture. You have a horseshoe kind of arch, and then you have different designs here, and most of them have a very nice jali work. You can say the panel had always something like this as an important element. So this is the typical Moroccan architecture, and you can see most of the things done in white or turquoise colors or something like that. And Bohemian is one style where all the colors are mixed, and you have indoor plants and all those kind of things. This is most liked by the younger generation, like 16, 17 years or 20 years old. Girls and boys generally want to have their rooms decorated in this, multicolored kind of scenario. And you can see some plantations here indoors. This is a typical landscaping which is blended. Nowadays we are doing a lot of indoor plantations, and we are calling it as interior landscaping, which is also a specialization. And you can see here fusion is the new trend, where we are mixing two different eras also. So you can see some things which is totally modern and some things which been there since ages. You can see some verticality here in the wallpapers and different color combinations for the sofas and modern hanging chairs and pendants and chandeliers. So there's a mix of something like a art deco and a modern, which is totally contemporary styles of using multiple colors. Flashy colors is one fusion, and I'll show you some other fusion where we can do fusions in many ways. So that is a new trend now, and how good you are at this is very important, and how disciplined you are in maintaining those elements. For example, if you look at this picture, this is a blend of English antique and Indian antique. So you can see that boat there, which is a typical Kerala sports boat, and you can see the flooring, which is a terracotta flooring, which are the elements from the South Indian style. And you can also see some nice pillars here, which are a typical chettinad style. But you can, if you see, look at the kind of chairs. These chairs are something like those klismos of the Greek. That's an English. The way the curtains are put is an English style. The way the table is arranged, the way the ceilings are done, it's all totally English style. So there's a blend here, and how well you blend these is the new fusion that we are crazy about nowadays. This is the trend now, which has been set, and very disciplinedly people compose things to get this. So I would always believe that it doesn't need any your talent or something like that, or your instinct to overlap, but it needs that technique to be learned, the skills to master, so that you can actually blend and you can compose a very nice thing. It would be as simple as, like, if you have how would that be if an actor is doing acting directly without even going to a school of acting? How does his performance, and what difference can it make in his performance, in his acting, compared to the person who's gone to a school of acting, and he's rendered all those skills, and then he's got the right flair, and then his talent is enhanced. How would that performance be? So it's like that, as simple as that. By instinct, a lot of people can try their hand on interiors, and ultimately end up contractors also, because it's going to be mix of lot of things beautifully done, but not in sync with each other. But if you do it, if you're trained to do that, you learn the skills, and it's anybody can do kind of skills. And once you know the techniques of designing, and once you address this element of why are we putting this here, why are we actually doing this thing, why are we putting this kind of curtain, why are we doing this flooring, when you define these, that is when you become a designer, and that needs little training. And now let us just take some few concepts. For example, you can do it like a homework also, but I'll just show you one work here, where how different things can be binded together to complete the design. For example, we're taking two from Roman from the antique style to from the modern style. So let me take just the Roman for your example, and rest you can actually do as your exercise. So if you look at this, you have a room where you have a wall to compose, and you have a furniture to put, and you have a flooring to do, and you have a ceiling to do. So if I look at this, like if I am taking up Roman, then what are the things, how do I compose this to make a very good design? So if I look at this, I'm taking a picture, I'm taking a picture from the Roman styles, and I'm seeing that this will be the ceiling that is very appropriate for this Roman style. And I'm also picking up those flooring, the rustic looking flooring for the same picture. And then I'm looking at those cornices. I'm looking at these walls and the kind of entrances for this wall treatment, where I can do empanelment, you know, have a chair rail, have a skirting, have a beautiful architrave on the top, and have a very nice frieze work on the top, and have cornices, brackets, and everything. Those kind of things can be, you know, embedded on this wall. And then if I go further, this is the picture I'm showing, that this is the cornice that I'm using here as my thing. I'm developing a mood board to understand what are the things that are going to come in this place. And if I look at the furniture, I'm putting a chaise lounge, which is very famous of the Roman the element from the Roman architecture. So these compose the whole thing. I mean, you can add many more things. You can, if you want to add some more things, like, you know, curtains or something like that, you can actually do it like a mood board. See, if you see this, this is the material board or the mood board, where you can see the picture here on the left side, where I have rendered all the furniture, and I'm actually trying to tell which material, which fabric, which tile, which color combinations, what are my draperies, what is everything coming here, is what that I have told in this one single mood board or material board. Fine. So this is how it works. So let's let you also choose one of these among these four things, and then you can actually see how you can do about, like, if you're working on a Renaissance, if you're working on an industrial or a, you know, Scandinavian theme, or a, you know, modern architecture, you can actually work on this at your leisure and see how you can actually compose a design. So we are actually coming to the end of the session, and if you are actually wanting to ask some things, you can actually do those thing. I can answer you. Hello. So anybody has any thing, you can actually text so that I can answer you. Anyone wants to ask some questions, then Yashwant Kumar, you had a question to ask? Yeah, I have a question. Okay, if you have any question regarding the course, I'll share a number with you. You can give this number, you can call this number 988-54-20202. Any questions regarding the course? 988-54-20202. So regarding the question of the kiddos, okay, the kids room. So I would actually go, you know, how we would design a kids room is like, I would understand the boys' taste or girls' taste. What are their likings? What are they fascinated about? The red colors or the orange colors? So mostly orange is an appetite-raising color, and you know, aqua blue is something that even the girls like and the boys like. So depending on that, depending on the age, and looking forward for at least about say 5 years, it will not be changed. Keeping that in mind, and having knowing their taste and all that, you can compose those things. You can take some reference pictures and then you can actually develop on that. You should not copy anything, but you should actually look at what suits that place. How is the lighting there, and you know, how old is the kid is very important. Like, you know, if they are teenagers, you have a different concept to make. If they are very small, just about 4 years or 5 years, you know, it has to be more brighter and, you know, accessible to you. The better way is not to have bunker beds, though you may like it, but the kids who are just about 4 years old may have problem actually using the bunker beds, though you may like it. I can see a question by Tejaswini Reddy. Is interior a best startup to settle? Yeah, it's a very good course now for interior designing. Is actually, you know, I have seen a lot of IT professionals also getting into interior designing course, and it's because they love this work. That's one thing. We are passionate about this work because we get to understand the person whose house we are building. We try to understand their habitats, we try to understand their world, and then we do it for them, and that gives more satisfaction. When a client comes up and says, wow, you have really made my house come to my dreams come true, you know how satisfying it is for ourselves. And so at the end of the day, the credit goes to you. Whatever work you do, the credit goes to you. Unlike in any other kind of careers, you have a hierarchy, and then you have to report to somebody else. Probably your work may be taken credit by somebody else. But interiors is something where all the designing, you know, all the execution, everything, you can be the whole and sole responsible person, and you get the credit for what you are doing. And today, even for a 1 lakh kitchen, people are looking for consultancy by designers, because it's very important that they don't mess up things. Better to take a professional advice rather than experimenting or, you know, self-medication kind of thing. So even for a 1 lakh project, people are approaching designers to get this done better. So that's very important. And regarding the job opportunities, there's so much of wide range. You know, even as you can see, interior designing itself being one of the verticals of architecture, it has interior designing itself has very many articles, verticals, in the sense like you have kitchens as specialization, you can do restaurant specialization, you can do, you know, event management as specializations, and you can do like individually, and you can also do like a freelancer. Or you can also work for somebody, you can work as an assistant designer to somebody, or actually you can do like a 3D view maker you have so much of variety in that. And more so ever, the new thing that is up in the market is project management. You do an interior designing course, a diploma, and then you do a project management course. That's a beautiful combo. Like, you know, if you can actually work on projects which go for a very less tenure, I mean 2 months, 3 months projects, and your project management skills are being used, and the faster you complete a project, the faster you reap the results. So it's very, very nice to have interior designing. I love to do interior designing more than architecture works because they complete fast. For example, suppose if I'm taking up a project, and you know, if they are completing in just 2 months, and even 10% of my fees is on that, that's a very nice remuneration over a period of 2 months. And I have vendors who would actually claim that, sir, hume 1 lakh square feet bhi de dijiye, hum 2 mahine mein complete karke de denge. I mean, that's the kind of thing that is there, that gives you the kick of, you know, working. When you have time schedules and you have things to complete, and this giving you satisfaction. Even for women, you can look at these options. Like, suppose you got married and then there is a break, you can come back again and you can start. You can start one by one, you can stop. Then when you're again getting back to work, you can again restart. At any point of time, you can take one project at a time. Just like, you know, you take up movies, right? So you can take one project at a time, you can do a good job. And once you get named as a very good designer, I mean, people will be chasing you. From different parts of the fields, different people may actually want you to do their work, and it requires a lot of patience and understanding their requirements, and it's a real good thing. And by the way, designing is something which is, when you're looking at customization, you're not putting your self there. I mean, you're not coming with options like what you feel like, but what is appropriate there. And that is really a challenging task, and that's really very nice to do a good job. And job opportunities, as you can see, from Hamsteck, a lot of people have been placed in IKEA and many other places and many big firms. And I would recommend that after the course of diploma, where one can actually do a full-time internship from morning to evening on one particular site. From all the 3 months or 2 months, as long as the project is there, from scratch to the end, so they will get to know everything. That is my recommendation, so that you can actually learn what are the different materials being used, who are the vendors who actually deal with this, who are the carpenters, painters, and the team that you have to accumulate to do your own work, and then you know what are the mishaps that can happen, what are the mismatches that can happen on site, which comes first, which comes later. All these things you will come to know while you do the internship. And the softwares that are being used today, we have AutoCAD, we have 3ds Max, 3ds Studio Max, which is very common, and then you have SketchUp, which is a fast rendering thing for 3D viewing. Earlier, architects and interior designers used to literally sketch by hand and show it to the client, and sometimes we would miss on communicating what ideas the designers used to have. But now we have softwares like SketchUp and 3ds Max, where we can actually render and show how's the output going to come. So this has become a big advantage. Even the people at this COVID times, I have a lot of projects where people are sitting at home and you know, sending me rendering images, developing, you know, a lot of concepts and things where we can share it to the clients, and the planning level is happening very nicely. Apart from the execution also, we got a lot of things, breakthroughs in this, as many of the carpenters and painters went away to their homelands. We found new technologies, new techniques of executing works. For example, we took a decision of you know, going to modular. In the kitchens, the wardrobes, and everything is being done modular in the factory. So that solved the time problems, like you know, not reaching the timelines by the regular carpenters and the painters. We could actually sum up the whole thing in a very less time, probably half the time. So that is the biggest advantage when you have problems like COVID. You always come up with little new opportunities. We looked for new materials which were easy to install and you know complete the project. So I have actually answered immediately after when you finish this course, designing course. If you have any like very nice acquaintance among in your society, in your family circle and all that, you can start your project. You can take some assistance in the beginning, but as you start doing, you will know a lot of things. How many years is something that being asked? If you are a 12th standard, then I would recommend that you go for a 4-year course. The details will be told by the counselor. But if you are already a graduate, it's easy to get the wavelengths of the technical aspects, like you know, firefighting system, what is air conditioning, what is electrical lighting, and all those kind of things, and many other material technical know-how will be easy to grasp if you are an already a graduate. And I would recommend for a 1-year course. If you are a 12th pass or a 10th pass, it's better to go for a full-time course of 3 years course or a 4 years course. So between 1 year and 2 year diploma, the main difference is like you're already a graduate, and then you don't have time, and then you're trying to look at all those things, and in 2 semesters you're trying you're working on all the parameters, and in 2 years the same curriculum will be little more exercised in the sense like you have an opportunity to do parallelly some internship also in a 2 years course, and you exercise in the sense like you have more work more work being done on the same thing. So in a 1 year you won't be able to do much, you won't be able to spend the more time. Like suppose you're learning perspectives, so you learn the basic perspectives, and here in 2 years you exercise on that a little more. Okay, so that's a choice actually. How do we charge per room is something different from as you how you charge for the project. So mostly the charges all depend. It may you can charge per square feet. I mean there are three types of services that we generally give. Either you give it in the form of consultancy where you do just the designing and you know you give 2D and 3D drawings, and that's about it. You go give some technical assistance on the site wherever some things are stuck up or something like that. You go for selections and all those things, and as you proceed towards project management, you also employ a supervisor and you see that everything is under control, even execution part. In the former you don't look into the construction or execution part, but in project management you take care of the design as well as the execution part. And in contract, you take care of the execution. You may not be the designer sometimes, but in contracting, you can do this. So these are the three types of services, and you have different ways of charging in different. In Hyderabad, it's charged as per square feet, anything from 100 rupees to 350 rupees per square feet. That's the highest to the, I mean, as per your branding in the market, you charge so much. I mean, it's a real good prospect, I mean, to choose this field. So, as I told you, interior designing is a vertical of architecture. So, if you're doing architecture, you may be mostly dealing with buildings. It may be a hospital building, hotel building, or a residence. But interior designing is talking about the inner fabrication, the insides within the six planes, the four walls and ceiling and flooring is what we are looking at. So interior designing is all about talking about the technicalities and the designing, space management, inch to inch, compared to architecture. Architecture overlooks all of these things, but interior designing goes into, I mean, the more sensitive you are towards details, this is the best place to be in interiors. Remodeling is always exciting, and it's the, you know, vision of the designer, how he wants to convert the space into something else. Mostly if you look at the today's trend is most of the things, the houses have been built some 25 years, 30 years back, so everybody is interested in remodeling. As you can see, place like Bombay and all that, where they have space constraints, they constantly, you know, for every year or 2 years, they constantly keep remodeling to accommodate a lot of things in the same space. So remodeling is really very interesting thing. Depending on what are the requirements of the client, we customize the space. In terms of institute, I would always recommend Hamstick, because we have a very systemized way of functioning, and our syllabus is very, JNFU approved, and we have many other boards, SNDT, SBTET, and we have a structured presentation by the faculties here. Everybody is well trained for more than five years, and the presentations are more lively and more so ever with practical inputs. That's very important, because what is important is the simulation as to how, what are the things happening outside. So when the simulation happens properly, you real time experience about what's going to be the work, how you handle. And in the second semester we deal with a lot of estimations, which are actually of the true examples of how you actually make estimations of wardrobes, the total house. So right now I find Hamstick to be fulfilling all the requirements in all the perspectives of becoming a designer and coming out and starting your own enterprise also. I always feel good that 1 year course is much sufficient, because there are a lot of things, your focus is totally there, completing the project, completing your assignments. If you are giving your luxury of time, there's always been drifting away from the from the main thing. So if you have 1 year, you have a target oriented thing, like you want to accommodate everything in that. And if you look at coming out from the institute and setting up your thing, you're coming into the market sooner than the rest of the crowd. So 1 year definitely helps in upgrading fastening up things for you to put yourself into the market and get known very soon. Yeah, I would recommend that any you're a graduate, whether you are a BA or a BCom or a BSc, doesn't matter. If you're a graduate, 1 year diploma course is fantastic for you. You can always opt for that. And interior designing, as you can see, it is having more expanse. The ratio is too much, the demand is more, and the supply is less. We need more designers to actually plunge into this so that we can actually cater to the needs of the thing, to the clients. Yeah, what are the things to keep in mind to come up with good fusion is when you actually enter the course, you will know what are the things, how do you blend different styles. So it's very very early to understand what are the different fusion things. Until you get a hand on every style, you can't really do fusing very easily. How do I decide between wood, tile and carpet? So depending on the maintenance and the acoustical issues, like for example, suppose if you're thinking of a home theater, so home theater generally needs a carpet rather than wooden or tile, because carpet is a very good absorbent of, you know, sound refraction, and it can nullify the effect of resounds and all that. Acoustically, that's the best solution. So carpet is appropriately used. In fact, carpet keeps you more warmer. It can be used not just home theater, it can be used in even in the halls. So all these things we'll learn as we do the course. And you know, wooden flooring is most recommended by for the elderly people, because as they get older, their nerves on the foot are very, you know, sensitive. So as they put their feet down on the marble or a granite or a vitrified tile flooring, they always they experience that you know, some kind of shock. The nerve endings may actually get damaged. So that's the reason why they are recommended that the wooden flooring is there or carpet is there in the bedrooms for them to have that you know, healthy thing. I mean, they don't suddenly meet with a contrasting temperature. Yeah, we do get job placements from Hamstack. There are more than, you know, every month we get more than 3,000 calls from different companies hiring people. And, you know, as per the competency of the students, we keep placing them. And we have large number of people joining companies like IKEA and many other top-notch interior designers like Supraja Rao and, you know, many architects here. In interior designers also, and even including Asian Paints, I think more than 7 color consultants in Asian Paints are from Hamstack. So you can see how the placements are being done. Yeah, how did suit the IT professionals? Yes, IT professionals, if you are passionate about you know, designing and decoration, and you being the responsible person, it is really very satisfying course, because unlike IT, you don't have to really upgrade. You have to upgrade only in terms of, like, you know, what are the new materials that are coming in the market, and you have to better understand the clients. So you are actually directly interacting with the clients, and not from, you know, somebody in the hierarchy as you see in the IT professional. So you are independently working as an entrepreneur. So that's the biggest advantage to take up this field. Yeah, we can always in fact, it's a feather in the hat for people who have already done civil engineering, because civil engineering mostly deals with the structural stability of the building. Even architecture is away from civil engineering. Architecture is to do with more of, you know, designing elements and planning and all that. But civil engineering is to do with more of, you know, bridges, you know, designing beams and columns and many other things. And for them, having done an interior designing course is a feather in the hat, because they can really do a lot of things in their projects. They can really incorporate beforehand while planning their buildings, and that would be an added advantage for the customers who are buying those buildings. is it possible to design a space with a particular concept for someone who can afford to spend less? Of course, yes, you can do. Not even 1 lakh, even lesser than that. If you are thinking of a concept, everything can be in sync with that, and you can. That's the working. You have to work little more harder to understand what are the things which will fall in the budget. But yes, you can discipline the whole selection of the elements under one roof, under one concept. Yeah, the subjects which will be there for a 1 year course, for a 2 year course, everything will be told by the counselor. But in just to give you in a nutshell, in the first semester you will be having subjects like materials, services, drawing, graphics and all that, and you have subjects like just introduction to design studio, and you have other subjects like history, and then as you go into the second semester you have professional practice where you learn the estimations, you have furniture designing in detail, then you have studio where you will be designing restaurants, and you'll be designing residence, office, and you know, commercial stuff also. So this is going to be the distribution of thing. Okay, so if you have any other queries, you can actually contact the counselor. I can repeat the number for you: 988-54-2022. That's a counselor's number. You can actually talk to them and get more details. And I think we can call off for the day today. Thank you for listening, and all the best for a beautiful career, wonderful career this is, and very passionate career actually. All the best. Wish you good luck. Thank you.